too young and new. I was young enough to know everything. And I did some CLMs. Anybody know what that means? Career limiting moves. I was that arrogant engineer who stood up in like the bigger than this department level meetings with that question for upper management. Because finally it was my chance to ask them. And so like three or four levels up. And I'm like, so this is some context in my position that makes no sense. Here's a word out of context that you said once and why you're terrible. Please respond. Right? I'm trying to exhibit power. I'm trying to like use the leverage of all of this big public forum to do that, not realizing that it was stupid and futile. But that was like, I mean, I didn't know any better at that time. I was not an adult power hacker. I was a black hacker. Right? So that's me using it in a negative way, trying to establish a little thing or get my position out there and make myself look good. And it was totally ineffective. I felt it in the moment. I didn't realize how dumb it was for years until I was like, oh. And then, now I feel bad about it, but, you know, they didn't care. They just dismissed me and I moved on to another company. So, I mean, they didn't get fired, but like, I didn't move on. So, okay. So, this stuff works better when you try. So that's what we're going to do now. I'm going to ask everybody to just stand up and get all the chairs out of the way so that big open area, please. And free your hand of all things. We leave the front table in place so we can upgrade that there. We'll get back to it.
Thank you.
clear eye over here. If you have to make an emotional noise or let something out, you can do that. Just don't talk. That was perfect. You did such a good job. Okay, back in your tribe. We'll start with the A's. A's. Now, was that different? You notice stuff going on there? Yeah. Actually, we get a lot of meaning from right here. But if you cover a baby's hand, we look up at the face to figure out what goes on. Because covering hands is sort of ambiguous, and they're like, wait, what? And then they look and determine from that. So a lot goes on here, and the eyes say a ton. So I've kind of really changed it into an extreme version of it. No one does that behavior to that degree all the time. So when I say this, I don't mean these lovely people, but what kind of people are they? Weird. Yeah! So weird. Introverted? What else? Insecure, shy, what else? Awkward, they're relaxed, powerless, interesting, they're too busy, they're unavailable, so here's your tip, what kind of people are they? Aggressive stalkers. Preposterous.
Confident.
Confident.
Rude.
Rude. Supercilious. Very interesting. Intimidating. Interested. Dominant.
Powerful.
And powerful. Fascinating. Just from that one little thing. Maybe I randomly selected you into all of the powerful, confident, arrogant people over here, and all the shy, introverted, dismissive people over here. So let's switch so you can try another thing. This time you will look and you'll look away, and you'll look and you'll look away. You will look and hold. Not psychotic, don't go after people. Not dramatically, just subtly make and break eye contact. Just keep doing the same thing for you, no matter who you interact with. Yeah. So if it's you and I and we're looking and holding, we're just gonna lock in until we get past people, and then we move fast. Yeah. Just comfortable. Not like that though. Don't make it like a thing. Just hold it, like comfortably. Like I'm talking to you now. It's not. You can't tell I'm like trying to make eye contact with each one of you. It's just subtle. I'm just doing it. Like, we do make eye contact. Just hold it a little longer. Don't ever. Okay. Let's go. Keep doing it, keep walking as I say this, but just check in and scan, starting with your toes and all the way up. What's going on with the body as you were doing this? Okay, back with your paper. How did you feel doing that just now? You felt closed, yeah. Where you felt awkward? Oh, you felt unfriendly? Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it's like, tune you out. I don't want contact. Ladies, are you familiar with that? Right? Yeah. Tune it out. New York, very much. People in New York do not connect. You can't. There's too many people, too many weird things in New York. It's those smaller dogs that are a different kind of weird, but it's still like weird. There's weird. Yeah, absolutely. But yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So it's amazing that it actually just changes your outfit, changes how you feel. And it's not like fake sort of feelings. They're real feelings. This will change your biochemistry, these physical things. It will change how you actually feel inside. Yeah?
I was just noticing that maintaining eye contact.
Feels pushy to them too. This can be problematic for other less enlightened people than you and me. That makes a big difference. But flirting and everything else, there's so much with who looks and when. That this watching cafes and bars is fascinating to watch this work happening. This is the language of power. All these are social cues and signals, and it's going on. All the time, you cannot opt out. You are doing it always, and so is everyone else. So it's interesting to tune in and start to awaken to some of this stuff, because it is powerful. One little thing, this stuff is real. So we're going to talk about some things and things to try. Don't indiscriminately go and try this at dark at midnight. Or things, right? Like, leave the world in a better place and watch where you experiment. Also, don't take everything we say tonight and say, Rich said to do this, this, and this, and I'll be powerful. I'm going to see the VCs. Don't do that. Practice this stuff and integrate it in slowly till you're comfortable with all these things, because people will read it. Like, you could read all kinds of stuff going on there. When I said to check in on your body, what was going on? Shake their fist at the world because they really don't have any power. Right? Being very comfortable and relaxed and calm is a signal of power. Yeah. You will take up more space. This whole group distributed a little bit more wide than this group. You're a little more group. And even now, hands in pockets and hands crossed like everybody and feel a little more together than this group over here, which is a little more open than like, I hold them. Would push it down the black shelf. Right? This is, we primed you for this, for all these behaviors that you can open up more. It was the opposite when I noticed in the first round when you had an arm. But this stuff hangs on. So, real feelings get changed by your physiology. You change one little thing and the body knows what to do. It goes into these. So we would call the look and look away, the hunched shoulders, all that lower stack. We would call the back up looking and holding eye contact high stats. They are not good and bad. They are actually more authoritative versus approachable. If you don't look and hold eye contact, you're more easy to go up to. Someone who is in there's no barrier to going up to you. You might not want it. It's like, things don't come up. But no one feels like, oh, I better not go. If you're doing that, they're like, yep, I'm going. Right? And this is true when they look, when they talk to criminals, people that, that commit crimes, this is the characteristic by which they choose their victims. If you are head up and looking powerful and alert, they'll be like, yeah, no, not you. But if you're like meager and trying to hide away, they're like, ah, check this out, right? Because these are the signals, and these are very deep, primal, go back to being all mammals kind of stuff. So, great. Thank you very much for playing along. Go into our seat. You do not have to get them in exact rows like they were. They were beautiful before, but just like, make yourself happy. Crazy questions about benefits and value. amazing technology. Let me tell you all about it. That was not the story that got us funding, as it turns out. I put almost the entire funding of the company, we had like accrued up like 15 grand back in the 90s, and I was like, I'm paying it all to this communication around, help me with the debt. That's the debt that got us funded. And not only did they do the debt, they changed me. They made me practice, they had me like doing all these crazy acting exercises and everything to try to present it in a different way. And then I went out and I started running into a wall, pitching to these scenes and getting nowhere until I learned it. So that was how I learned how to hack power for myself and how you pitch and influence other people, which I got help doing. It was called, I think, Sterling Communication. Are they still? Okay, yeah. So, I've been talking for a long time. But that's where I started to learn some of this stuff, because my degree, out of 128 hours, I think 21 were not core tech classes. It was like one speech class, four philosophy, and a couple psych classes. And they're like, yep, go ahead, here. A fully engaged human for the world. Totally not right. Totally not what I need. I should have a lot more for the track that I wanted to take. So, okay. This language of power is universal. It is everywhere, all over the place. Which one of these is the higher status animal? One over here. How do you know? What can you point to in that picture that makes you know that? Mouth wide open?
The other one's leaning
back. Yeah?
Claim space.
Claim it. What do you mean claiming space? Let me see.
It's things that fall and touches.
This one's invading this one's space enough to even touch it. Yeah, absolutely. Size doesn't matter. Right? It is true for big cats and for little cats. Same behaviors. Dogs, too. Which one here? This one. Anybody disagree? A little bit of ambiguity in this one. Yeah. There's a little bit of ambiguity, partly because of the angle and partly because this is frozen in time. Like there's things we can't see that could affect it. But what are you seeing here? What are the things you can point to that tell the story language of power? Yes?
Pointing,
like looking at this,
the
dog on
the left,
brown. Giving it inside. Yeah. Yeah.
And even the
face,
like,
there's
more.
Yep. Clear intent.
Well,
how do
you
see clear intent?
It's pretty clear what this one's projecting, right?
It's how? Clear. What makes it clear? How do we know?
All the physiology. It's a eye. It's exactly what it's projecting, right? It's projecting.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I mean, most people agree with that. And that's, we know this stuff. There's a way in which you're already experts at it. But when we try to get in, it's things like you mentioned the eye and where it's going. It's above these eyes. The ears back. Those things. Bearing, showing the teeth. These are all the little signals that we're just like, we collectively make that judgment. In 7 milliseconds, I think it is, we make a judgment on someone else as soon as we see them. We do a social evaluation. Our brains at rest stand for social cues. Because we are a herd animal, and we were not the top of the food chain. Right? So it makes a difference. If I do that, everybody gets like, whoa, wait, what's he looking at? And we all want to turn. It's a herd behavior. Happens naturally because it keeps us safe. The people that don't tune into that, not eat. Right? The whole like pack looked up, turned, started to go, and was like, where do you go? cool. That's the entire thing, right? So we're very tuned into this and making snap judgments. We don't necessarily know what are the component pieces. If we know, we can learn to read them better than other people, key off of those, and then learn to control them ourselves. Yeah.
Like, I
Yeah, so yelling and trying to get power is, it's not a matter of degree. Acts of aggression happen, just for us, they happen in different ways than biting them. But, you know, biting comments, people slight things, those are acts of aggression too. And there's this whole thing of microaggressions that is kind of popping up, but that's it looks different now how we act out aggressively, because we put the sticks and the stones down a while ago, but it used to be we would just actually battle for it, and that's how it would show up. They're less involved. Slightly, I love dogs, but slightly less involved.
So it's a control
mission. Yes. Yeah, exactly. It's all about, yeah, being in control. Size doesn't matter, and this is where we learn it, right? This is a super fierce little puppy. Look at that, like this snarling, the eyes, the ears are out and up. And this dog is saying, if you make this face, the other dog should do this. Right? Huh? They are playing. And they are playing in learning this language. They're playing in the language of power. Who's in control? It's a play fight. Right? But we learn it from here, and we keep learning it all the way through. It's right from the beginning. And it works cross species, because this is definitely invading the space of this poor puppy with his eyes down. And it works cross species here, because I communicate to my dog in this. I don't know all of their language, but I know some. And I definitely use this in training. Season one, his entire oeuvre of work was based on this kind of dominant submission. It's not the only or best necessarily thing with dogs or how to do it, but that was definitely what he was tuning into. And I have definitely seen and used this at dog parks where things have happened and dogs were in the fights or whatever, or they come barking up at me, and there is a whole, I am super aware of the communication and language and what's going on. Yes, I recommend holding their tail. Yeah. No, it absolutely is what's going on. And in fact, it's a very difficult conversation to have in power with VCs. They control a resource that you want. And you have to approach them in a way that you don't try to overshoot and go above them. But if you're down here, they're like, great, next. Because you're not going to go and get me enough money. So you've got to shoot for getting close enough and navigate that without going over. Yeah.
So, going back to the little subtle picture that you showed a couple of slides ago, I didn't really talk very carefully about the gear and the angles and so forth. I kind of had some feeling as soon as I saw the snapshot.
Yep.
So, one thing that I'm kind of wondering is this conscious interpretation of the image, or is that basically going to some level of automatic subconscious level? In other words, is it like system wired or system two by Daniel Kahneman's language?
Both. So we will automatically, our brains are hardwired to make a snap judgment, friend or foe, and assess things very quickly. And if you stay with it and begin to become aware of it, you can learn to read it on a more conscious level. And then make choices. So you can read, what is that person trying to do? Are they trying to establish or increase their power or not? And then, how do I want to respond? So if you see that VC, and they make a play to become a little bit more powerful, coming back with more power may not be the choice you want to make. You have to make the decision then. But you have more tools by raising your consciousness. So the first thing all of this work is, and why I'm showing you this stuff, is to raise your consciousness on, you can tune in and start to learn to read this. You will see it everywhere. I've got a big long list of behaviors you can take a look at. And it doesn't matter, age doesn't matter here either. Even the smallest child can be higher status than this dog physically could take the child out. This child is not equipped for battle yet, it's too young. But this grooming behavior is very, I am serving, I am giving respect and power to you. It all kind of comes down to kumbaya kumbaya in terms of the yelling and everything else. It's either you're saying, don't back off or I will bite you, and you know I can back that up, or you're saying, don't bite me, I'm not worth fighting. On a very basic level, that's what we're talking about. Yes. Yeah, this is very natural, and it is a one dimension of what is going on. But you said multidimensional is also very contextual, what is happening. But in every relationship, there is a who is in charge of and who has more power. We're always, in fact, you can't hold power by yourself. You only can hold it in relationship to someone else. Has to be a transaction in a relationship. And the most successful relationships are the ones where you know who's one and who's two, and it's well defined and agreed upon. And it can change based on context. In fact, very successful relationships, especially like partnered relationships, if you know who's in charge with cooking, and you know who's in charge with navigating, and those just, we just know and defer to that, it works out better than having it always fight, because when it's unknown, we seek knowing. And the way we seek knowing can come out in aggression or battle or fighting or who's in control. And as soon as it's known, we all relax. We think we want equity, but it turns out even in tests, we don't want equity. We want certainty. And we're much more comfortable knowing who's in charge. Actually, we did a study, or we did, there was a study done, MBA students. You're going to do a project. It's a complex project. And you get to choose going into it. Do you want to be number one, two, three, or four in terms of who's in charge? What do you think the majority of MBA students chose?
Two.
Number one?
Four.
Number two. Why number two?
Because it's close enough to the top, but not actually responsible.
Bingo. Great power comes from your responsibility. You're not on the hook. You are influential enough. So, being the founder and CEO, you've chosen one, if that's what your choice is. The really good teams, it's a co-founding group, and one and two are well established. Yeah, Bates and Allen, they knew. They knew who was doing what, and they were happy in those positions. A lot of people like number two. If you're a founder and you're number one, find your number two. It makes a huge difference, and it keeps it very clear, and you have different skill sets, and you apply different things. Yeah?
I was thinking you broke this down into two categories, who's going to bite and who's not going to bit.
Mm-hmm.
This seems to be kind of a third, that the white dog there seems to be basically defensive, but projecting a sense of, you really don't want to try me.
Yeah.
I don't want to fight you, but...
It's hard to say because it's a snapshot of time. This looks like an attempted bite and a coming over the top and invading. I think the white one ends up on top for the yellow one, isn't it? But as soon as we start to hit play and time starts moving, we've got another dimension of all this stuff. The pictures are difficult and a little bit ambiguous.
Where I was going, though, was just that there's a level at which you try to make yourself look big. When you're in confrontation, it's not actually deferring, and it's not actually aggression.
Yeah.
It's defense.
Yeah, and there's a try to make yourself look big and making yourself big that are different. So, with all of this stuff, none of this is about put it on, try to do it, fake it, put on a thing. It's being authentic, which is about like a whole deal now. What I mean is, it's being aligned emotionally with where you are and projecting out the truth of that. That's what I mean by being authentic. It is about being big. It's about deciding to, I am going to be big, as opposed to trying to be big, which is there's just slightly more, but you can see how I'm like, I don't really believe how big I am now. I'm trying to show you how big, which is different than just taking up as much space as I can and slowing down. So it's a subtle difference, but we're really good at reading the false bravado, the false application. So, and this stuff definitely has impact. So, you called it earlier, imagine your favorite or least favorite politician and how they show up. This was big news, right? This is big news because we all can see it, we're all reading it, but no matter what side you're on, it says, this looks like a poster from a 1970s horror movie. Right? And it kind of does. And just like the dog from the cat, you can call up specific things about eye behavior and where they're standing and him, like, relative position and all those things. If we're watching this, this is news because everybody knows it, sees it, and reads it. But it's not only here. It's here every election. These are power things. They can call you Joe. It's familiar. It's communicative. I easily can call, what, at the time, Senator Biden. I would call him Joe. Right? That's really familiar. It's not formal at all. It's not what the language of diplomacy is. It's, he's not a big deal. I'll call him Joe. In here, there was a lot in the first debate with Obama and Romney, and Pulse over all the debate with opening debates with Romney, but President Obama sleepwalked his way through it. His brow here, it's still hard to see the lights, but he's sort of like apologetically, he's like a law professor here. He's so wonky, and it's like, well, if you consider all the arguments in the Constitution, it's like, blah, 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 right? He totally changed, and I want to coach him. President Obama, a totally different act. And here is the opposite. A very sick, Romney's shoulders are totally dead, he looks stiff, and Obama is leaning forward and puts in his hand, invading his face. Just this. And this is headline news, because this is a big deal. Throwing the shoe, who puts whose hand on whose shoulders to give him a bat, and all this stuff is really important. All keep up with it. It's just as important in the one-on-one conversations you have, trying to get a customer to sign, trying to get a person to join for not enough money and a hope for some stock. Like, all those conversations are about, can you win them over? Can you be believable, confident in you and your stuff? They're buying you and your family, team, and company. So, and you can overshoot in these high-stakes environments and make mistakes, and I did. I was on the project several years ago now, where I went in and I was supposed to coach these high-powered people and the number two guy in the whole organization. I'm going through my briefing meeting. And I was a little unaware, it's a different country, and I was like, not totally sure. And I walk into the briefing, and I sit down at the office, and he's in there, and I start talking, and he turns, and he does an email, and then he does two texts, and then he takes a phone call, and he goes back to an email, and I'm like, who are you? I'm here to brief you. So I stop talking until I get eye contact. I just stop mid-sentence until he gives me eye contact. And he does, and I start talking again. Up to then, I think I'm okay. I've just asserted myself. He turns back to the email, and I stop again, same sentence, and wait for him. And I blew it. I totally burned this guy. I came in too hot. He's a VC. I've lost the money. That guy tried to get me fired for 2 months because I did that. So you can make mistakes with this, even after you have some experience with it. It can happen. So when you go to experiment with this, make sure you're comfortable and you're reading it and making good choices. And even with some level of expertise, you can mess up on this stuff. So it's real and has impact. So I said, be a little careful with it, but practice it. What we want is, you each have a range right now on this approachability and authority that you're comfortable in. We need to expand that to the widest range that we can. Because that range has been set by your experience, your schooling, your parents, it's great. It's perfect as it is. But if you expand it more, you have more people you can connect with, more relationships with more kinds of people, and more tools in your toolkit you can use to influence others. So it's worthy to work on expanding. All these stories are going to be messing up. I have one that I do okay at the end. So, when you are already an expert in this, what do you see? Yes. Most people saw someone walking, but she saw dots. That is actually accurate. This is, I think it's 15 dots. Right? The dots come from the average of 300 people wearing light, little lights and walking in the dark together. But it's all real people, and it is people walking. It's kind of amazing with it's almost 15 bits of information, we can see a person walking. That is a tiny amount of information. Have you ever seen somebody you know well walking at you like a long way down the beach, and you're like, oh, yeah, that's them. You can't even come close to seeing, but you know that person enough. We're very good at this. We're already very good at this. So the fact that you can see the things in the dogs and all this, you're tuned in, it's just about being aware and honing it. What about this? Is this different?
Less educated person.
It's a less educated person. It's a male? What?
A comedian?
A comedian? Arrogant. What else? An athlete. Oh, yeah.
I can see that.
A soldier. Interesting. Is it different than this one? Oh, no, it doesn't work. It's the back.
Yeah,
it's going forward. Is it different than... Oops. This one.
Yeah.
No, it's a lady. It's a lady and everyone laughs. No one laughs on the other one. It happens every time. It's fascinating. There's something going on there. So, here they both are side by side. So, men with their shoulders. That's what we said on this one. What was that?
The hips.
The hips. Yeah, the hips are moving, the one on the right, move both of these, okay. What else do you see? How do you know that it's a man or a woman? Look, that's correct, by the way. The legs are together here. Knees are together. It's solid. What do you mean solid? Yeah, it doesn't move as much. Yeah. Which one's easier to knock over? You're going to run up and knock it over. Does she?
Yeah.
Most women identify that she does. I don't know in the study if that is true or not. But most women identify that and say that. Yeah, this one's definitely easier to knock over. So back to that, back when we had sticks and stones kind of thing, power was dictated by your level of brawn and physicality. It's not that way anymore. It's much more subtle. Did 4 and 5 year old girls walk this way? They walk a little more like this. Right? Not totally. But 8 and 9 year old boys start walking like this before there's any muscle mass here to make those arms go up. Right? These are learned behaviors. The hips is not anatomical. It has nothing to do. The hips are different anatomically, but the walk has nothing to do with the anatomy. It's connected with puberty, but it's behavior. It is in both of these, there are signals being given about let's get together and make more of us, right? That's part of that equation. But the World Cup champion women's FIFA soccer team does not want to feel like this. They may well go up to the bar after being like this, and there's some good reasons why they might want to do that, but they don't. It is not. We learn how to do both of these things, and they are learning to communicate with sign language of power. How we physically show up. We saw earlier with the eye behavior, it changes you physically. You want to think about, how do I want to show up? So, if you have a meeting, or you're going in, you're trying to exert some authority, you might not want to walk in this way. It might be your most comfortable, it might be your most sexy, it might be your best, but it may not communicate what you're trying to communicate at the time. You may not want to come in and announce layoffs like this. Like, all right, we're going to do some layoffs. Right? That is not going to match well. What you want to do is align the message that you're doing with everything that you're putting out in the world. Again, it's not the message. It's not the words. It's not the ice cream. It's how you present it. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely.
You haven't talked about that at all so far.
So, there is power not just in the high status and the authority side, there is power in the low status and the approachability side. It is, you can use both as a way to influence other people. It's where are they and what's the relative difference. So, some of the power stuff in the aggression is easier to see, and historically, because of a mostly patriarchal society, the markers for how we see and perceive power as a society are geared toward the masculine. But there is a lot about feminine, and as we get into a more collaborative mode, community and collaboration, and women in leadership and management, that is where they actually have advantage because of the different socialization that happens as a child. Like, team sports that are slanted usually more toward boys are competitive. It's like the version of knocking antlers together and getting weights. They are intrinsically more competitive. When girls tend to have more social games that they play, like nobody wins at house and other things, games that girls typically are socialized into, so they have a different set of skills. The power stuff that used to be more command and control, hierarchy, patriarchy, is fading away. Maybe not fast enough for some of us want it, but it is fading away, and a much more collaborative networked environment is It's well known now. Yep.
I actually had a comment on that. If you look at her, how she walks, she emphasizes her sort of kind of feminine when she walks like that.
Yep.
And when she talks about the fact that it's like somebody is influencing you with aggression and with dominance, she's kind of like projecting, oh, I'm weak, protecting kind of thing. So the other person from the lower status also can afford to be given.
Absolutely. And you can derive great power from that by playing low, by not challenging aggression, by playing more low status to it, you can lead that person around in many cases. In fact, I don't have any data on this, but Donald Trump is, I think, very easily influenced, and there's been a lot of power by flattery and engaging in narcissism. Reinforce his power with a maybe it's more feminine, but a lower status thing. Make sure that you are reinforcing publishing power and insert the ideas. I think it's a very easy manipulation for someone like that. So you definitely can get power from both things. Friend of mine tells a story about his dog where the dog has a thorn in the paw, and they both know it. And he's like, all right, don't worry about it. I'm going to get this. All right, come here. And he goes at this very aggressive thing, and the dog's like, and his wife is like, let me try. She's like, hello, how are you? Very low. He comes over and he's like, oh, you have something in your room. And then they get the, hey, isn't that the dog totally happy? Power over the dog in control by not doing this masculine thing because it's not controlled for in that situation. So there is a giant amount of gender-based stuff in power in this, and it is wrapped up in sex, and there is sexual power, and women can use it very effectively, even in the work environment, which is not in the sexual harassment, and Uber, and other things, but it can be an effective use, and we know that people who are seen as attractive can get more power to do things. We know that physical size, taller people, tend to hold more power. These things are all true. It's a delicate thing to talk about. People who can effectively assert their sexual power in an appropriate setting in work, and I'm not talking about oppression or anything like that, can be very effective, but that can be also a very uncomfortable area. So we don't do a lot on it, and we don't have a ton of data on it, so we tend to avoid it a little bit. It is a real thing. And it can be really effective. And if you can pull it off, definitely you should use that and leverage everything that you have. Okay, that's my doubts. Alright. Stop working. Put it on loop. Okay. This all comes from the Biomotion Lab, Queen University of Canada, and you can play with the sliders. They did it in a binary gender, is how they have done this study. So when it was male and female, when we said it was a man and woman, that's moving that slider, and it just sectioned people out of the average of what's generated. It's a much complex story from that, but in that division, there's other ones you can play with in there. Cards on your head, get up, pop lower, some in the middle, and then some outliers that are very different from the people around. So it's all interesting. So if you are correctly up here and correctly in the higher ones, the gap between skinny bases, why, how did you know? Which was like what? Yeah, what did that look like? What was that approach?
It was deferential, trying to make friends, trying to get me to like them so that I would move in the direction they wanted to.
Yeah.
That's the eye contact. It's like, well, it can't be really down.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Delighted to spend time.
Yeah. Yeah, that's Lows. Lows that were correctly in this area. How did you know this is where you should be? Yeah? Amazing. Oh, sorry. No, sorry. It happens though, right? If you're talking to them, you're like, yeah. It's the same move, right? It is, I am, this is more important than you. It, yeah, it definitely happens. What else?
That happened to me too.
You did?
Yeah.
Same person?
Same person.
Ah, yeah.
But they weren't excited to see whether they were looking at the car or they were looking at the car.
They weren't excited. How did you know they weren't excited? Right? Yeah, their eyes looked and then looked for something else. Yeah.
They all wanted to assign me task and for time from engineering.
Yep. Okay. What was that?
What if you were like indifferent?
They were indifferent.
I thought I was like number 5-6.
Yeah.
In case, then nobody's like shouting at me or even giving me the space. So.
Right. Okay, middle, what's going on in here? What were your signals that said?
Actually, I was just misplaced, but that part was for the first time in my life.
Ah! It's good to know.
I was trying to be where they
were. Got it, okay. Yeah.
Most people are talking to me like beer. So, like, on the same step.
Uh huh.
So I thought, like, it would be written somewhere.
Yeah, so some low and some high, both were like.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else? Yes.
Around 60-70% were like ordinary conversations, but they were the remaining who said, oh, I think your day is going really well. So that's when I thought maybe I have a
better.
So
a little bit lower, yeah.
And it was again an expression, so you would be that bad, but you're not there yet.
Right. Slightly encouraging.
Correct.
Like, oh, you're going to get there. Hang in there. Yeah, fascinating. Okay, outliers. If you are far away from the other part, like, yeah, one here and one down here, what did other people do to reinforce that that's what you were doing?
When I talked to them, oh, yeah.
All right. What about you? Did anybody have conversations with her? Yeah. What were they like? Like, how did she get this impression? I think it's probably a question. Were you more approachable side?
Yeah. So this game was very interesting to me. It always reminded me of the pretty interesting organization. There's an alpha log, and everybody's starting to have funny
bureaucracy. Let's talk about that. And now that we know it's there, what can we do about it? So, you can be high status and high on work, and you're called strong agricultural protest. Let me go for one for your TV persona shows up in that way. Clearly very powerful, very high status, but also very nurturing. It's a little bit of a grandmother archetype that works very well. It's very powerful. Whereas low status and low work is sort of very low and weak and repellent. So, work is another aspect. There are lots of ways to be trying to do that. Now, let's say, I think, we're going to skip this. We talked about that a lot. Status behaviors. That's what we're talking about. How can you make changes to this? If you want, I guess the premise is, if you change you and how the behaviors and how you physically show up and how you vocally show up, it will change the dynamics of that relationship. So if people have you pegged in one thing, this is really effective to change how you show up. It also is it's easier to influence other people with this than it is the words. Because when you start getting all of that intellectual processing and analyzing the argument side, and you try to lay out all those words, there's a lot to push against if you keep your ideas simple and use these methods is very effective. So you can try to play high to get more power and status by keeping your head still. Officers get trained in this. You ever get pulled over? I have before. You have. Watch how they approach it. It is very much a I'm in control. You are not to keep your head very still. Military development. Speaking in complete sentences as opposed to. You don't really always, if you don't finish, you see how I seem less authoritative when I don't finish the sentence? Speak simple, complete sentences. Much more on high. Hold eye contact, move very smoothly as opposed to fidgeting a lot, occupy a lot of space, you can lean back, be comfortable, slow down. When you're walking, assume other people are moving. It's a very high status way to be. Don't check if other eye react others for their eye reaction. Or don't check other people's eyes for reactions to what you said. You don't care what they react to. You can just say whatever you want. No visible reaction to other people, at least when it's great at that. Interrupt before you know what you're gonna say. This one, Donald Trump is so powerful, he can interrupt Donald Trump. It's a vocal tick that he does. He will interrupt himself multiple times. I think it is a fascinating thing. I have not seen it done before, but I think that's what's going on. It's not even picking up. Get your body open and wide. Stand more like this, which, in terms of wardrobe, I can't stand like this in a pencil skirt. Think about the wardrobe when you want to take on power that helps reinforce it. Standing like this, having to stand like this, all this is playing low enough. Playing low is about fleeting and jerky movements, keeping your hands on your face when you're speaking, glancing around, looking away. Everybody put your toes in. Put your knees together, and then sort of do this with your hands. It is not a high power place, right? I'm not saying you should do any of these. I'm saying these are the things that signal playing lower status. So you can choose how you want to use them. But these all come actually from the theater, from a man Keith Johnstone in a book called Improv, which is one of the fundamental books on improv. And his second chapter in it is called Status. And a lot of it comes back to primate research. So we are all just fancy dressed monkeys. And a lot of the same stuff that happens there is going on here. So, the thing is, in terms of how you change with other people, you can not just affect yourself, you can affect them. You can raise other people's status by asking permission to do something, ask their opinion, ask them for help or advice, express gratitude for something, apologize to them. All these raise them up. So there's somebody who's a little unsure about their status and things, and you raise them up, they will get more of a sense of power, authority, and control, and might free up resources and allow you to grant you access because they are feeling better. It's not just flattery, but it is definitely tied in. Flattery helps raise someone's status. So, you can also do this for other people. And one of the things that I love to do is brag on other people, or especially, one thing that very commonly happens that is gender-based is women will say an idea, and a minute later, men will say the idea, and everyone will say, good idea. Go back and attribute that. If you can't raise somebody else's status, say, that is a great idea. I think that Sally brought that up about a minute ago, and I really like what she said about it. Don't let it go by and get missed. Get allies, both men and women allies, to reinforce these ideas to help directly. So raise other people's status. You can also lower other people's status. This is not very nice to do, but if you need to establish power, or if somebody has taken more power than their employer they should have, these things will do that. Mention a failure, or exploring your own, sorry. Mentioning your own failures and shortcomings, obey and questioningly back down the conflict and out of the way. These can be really useful if someone is coming at you with aggression to de-escalate the situation. If you need aggression with aggression, you will get more. This can help the escalator. But you can lower others by criticizing them, correcting them, insulting them, giving them unsolicited advice. It's not really a good color for you. Right? It's very rude behavior, but it does have an effect. So I'm not saying you should do these things. People will do them, and you can help them out. So you can raise other people's status. You can surround yourself by the people that report to you and raise them up, and then you come up with it. In fact, there's a thing called the marzipan layer, if the marzipan comes right under the icing. The power of the people on top is derived from people below, and power is derived by people giving you power. So you are dependent on others. So having results. There's like one male monkey that's the dominant alpha, and a whole court of females that do all of the police work. And they go and go after the others, and all of the authorities derive to that second layer. So bring a layer in under, raise them up, and let them raise your status. It's a great way of both empowering them, but also maintaining your status in the organization.
Call that dispensing.
Yeah. You can also share it. Like, you know the cocktail party where everybody's standing around talking in a circle and somebody approaches? And the circle either like closes in slightly or it opens up and lets them in. But it's not a big conversation. You don't have a little vote or a debate. It just happens. Like, we're tuned into that. But one thing you could do is you can use your power of being in the circle to be like, hey, come join us. And open up. Now you own this much power and you can. Let them borrow. So it's a very good power. Yeah.
One thing, so a point history in business to business sales and presenting shows and things like that. And one of the things is a female hand off the bottle power to people. And so if you have somebody who's a support person supplying supplemental information, you need to give them credibility in that interaction.
Yep.
And by turning your shoulders completely to them and saying, you know, we're now using expectations, by directing that to get them in the ball, and then when it's your turn to come back again, they put our coach when they throw it right back again.
Yep. That's a great leadership move. I've seen the opposite happen. I saw another couple of trainers that got in on the company, had a person up there, they delivered a whole segment, and they got up and said, that was great, Jeff. We really like that one thing, and then redid the whole section. That guy's credibility was gone with that. He couldn't do anything after that. It was a terror. It was the opposite of that move. Yeah, empowering people is a very important thing. So my sister's story now is learning behavior, treat power, and achieve outcomes. Because all of this is, define the outcome that you want. Use your power to serve other people and protect the group. And then exert it. Don't be afraid of wielding your power, of using your power in that way of serving other people. If you do it to be self-serving, the group will not take it nearly as well. If you do it on behalf of the group, you will really engender loyalty. So it's okay. Most of us are a little bit afraid of exerting our power, and we can do it more than we think we can. So, this stuff is all based on acting as a way of practicing this stuff in a safe environment. The thoughts I think is called acting as power. We do improv, we do scripted scenes of plays to practice this so you can build the skills. So if you want to work on this stuff, take an acting class or take an improv class. They are all up and down the peninsula, around the bay, and other cities all over the world. It's super fun, but you will work on all these things. Because at the end of the day, acting is not about pretending. What I'm talking about is now put all these false behaviors and body language and these little tricks or neurolinguistic programming kind of stuff. I'm not about authentically finding the truth of this. Because acting is about finding the truth. When you see an actor that's bad, they're pretending. It's like a little kid making a mad face. That does not look mad. That looks like a kid making a mad face. Mad looks much different. Yeah, but the hands and the hips thing, but it looks kind of foolish, actually, right? But it's the thing we know, though, is we know how to put on in the signals. Absent, essence, and other behaviors. What can you do that if you shift, it will change the dynamic? If you think that is not true, go home to your partner and just start talking really slow and a lot of silence. They will notice. You can change the relationship, right? When they did that last time, when you did that thing you weren't supposed to do, and they were upset, you could read it. They made all those changes, and it changes how you approach it. You walk it, you get more nice, you do more, you like make dinner, like you do all these other things, because they change physically how they work. That will work for you at work as well. Use it for good.